Dear Miss Battaglini, dear colleague Potocnik, members of the European Parliament, ladies and gentlemen, let me thank your initiative, the Renewables Grid Initiative, and the Smart Energy for Europe platform for having taken this initiative to organize an event in such a timely fashion. I witnessed the signing of the European Grid Declaration on Electricity Network Expansion and Nature Conservation at the first European Grid Conference last year. And I'm very pleased to be here again today with my colleague, Commissioner Potocnik. Our joint participation here today demonstrates that environmental protection and grid development can and should go hand in hand. And your grid companies and environmental organizations who decided to set joining forces for renewable grids is the only way forward knows this better than anyone else. I'm very pleased to be able to announce that we have reached a breakthrough for modern energy infrastructure development. We achieved an agreement on the regulation on guidelines for trans-European energy infrastructure last week. This new regulation can pave the way for a modern pan-European network and brings us one step closer to the transition to a low-carbon economy. More concretely, the infrastructure regulation identifies 12 priority corridors and includes ways of identifying energy infrastructure projects that can receive the label of projects of common interest, or PCI. Projects of common interest will also be granted priority status at national level in the permit granting procedures. The regulation sets out a new method of trans-European infrastructure planning and enhanced rules for transparency. Finally, it introduces measures to shorten permit granting procedures. For instance, the Dutch authorities have pushed the duration of the procedures down from 15 years to 6 years for certain projects. Similar efforts have been undertaken in the UK and in Ireland. But given the urgency of developing energy infrastructures, we have to be faster. A time limit of around 4 years will stimulate a more efficient definition and handling of procedures without compromising the high standards for the protection of the environment and public participation. Once the infrastructure regulation enters into force, it is up to all of us to ensure its implementation together, because the challenge we face is unprecedented. The good news is the way energy is generated, transported, and stored is changing. Europe has seen quite impressive growth in renewables over the past years, from 4.5% growth per year in the last decade, it should reach 6.3% in the period 2010 to 2020. Most member states have in fact already reached their 2011-2012 interim targets as established in the 2009 Renewables Directive. But that is only the beginning. The share of renewable energy sources used to generate power is expected to nearly double from 19% today to around 35% in 2020. The role of variable energy sources, such as wind and solar power, is increasing. Over 40 gigawatts of installed capacity are foreseen for offshore wind alone. This is an immense challenge for the grid, the energy supply in general, and hence also our economies that rely on stable and reliable energy supply. Ladies and gentlemen, current infrastructure does not allow support of large-scale deployment of renewable sources. Everyone is in favor of more renewables, but not everyone knows that for this, the infrastructure has to be developed at the same pace. Electricity grids will have to cope with steadily increasing demand, with increasing electrification of energy, changing demand patterns, and increasingly variable supplies, both from centralized production as well as from many small and decentralized producers of renewable energy. Nevertheless, the biggest challenge we face in the immediate future is investment. We are approaching a make or break point for Europe's ability to support energy infrastructure investment. Europe has to boost its support for energy infrastructure. For example, one region where we need to focus our effort is the North Sea, which is an area clearly identified in our infrastructure regulation. Building the North Sea's offshore grid is a case in point. It will make a significant contribution to Europe's future energy needs, secure electricity supply, free of carbon emissions and affordable price. It will connect Europe with its greatest domestic energy resource, offshore wind. In the future, this will take a significant place in the production of electricity in our European Union. Investing in grids for renewables is a win-win situation. It can also help us achieving the energy and climate change objectives we signed up, as well as our goal to remove all remaining energy islands by creating a fully integrated and interconnected energy market in Europe by 2014. We have to act now. From an investor's point of view, 2020 was yesterday, and 2030 is just tomorrow. This is why we have established rules and methods for trans-European infrastructure planning, because the infrastructure will increasingly have to be built across national borders. The massive investments needed over the next decades, over 1 trillion euro for energy generation and transport by 2020 for all of the EU, against the background of low growth and recession in most EU countries, calls for coordination of investments. And this is why the Commission has come up with a Connecting Europe facility, which proposes to allocate funds using both financial instruments and grants in a flexible way, and thereby ensuring optimal use of EU budget resources. This is the very first time that the EU will co-finance the construction of large energy infrastructure from its regular budget. Our regulation, together with the Connecting Europe facility, will contribute to deliver on all the priorities. The guidelines provide for an improved planning and a stronger focus on EU-wide priorities with a new way of identifying projects which could be considered of common interest. Let me give some examples. Connecting Europe facility could finance innovative projects to store electricity. CEF could support an offshore grid in the Northern Seas to transport electricity produced by offshore wind parks to consumers. And Connecting Europe facility, CEF, will enable cross-border electricity interconnections which increase security of supply in Europe, and so on. Ladies and gentlemen, let me conclude with a few thoughts on public acceptance, the theme of both last year's and this year's GRID conference. Without the support of the public, we will not go ahead with our projects. A true and honest dialogue with our citizens in the EU, with NGOs, with network operators, with regulators, and with investors, community is needed. The Commission intends to lead by example here, consultation of stakeholders is a key part of the whole process. For example, last summer a public consultation was launched on the initial list of projects that have been submitted to be considered as potential PCIs. And an information day on the process of identification of PCIs took place. The purpose of this consultation was to engage directly with stakeholders and to allow their views to be heard in an early phase. We want to make this process as transparent as possible. We want to learn from each other. This is why we are here today. Therefore, we have to exchange lessons learned across Europe. Let me give you just a few examples of best practice cases on public participation in Europe. In the UK, the involvement of underrepresented groups and areas and target groups with specific needs is part of a stakeholder consultation. In France, the use of new and social media reaches out to a broader audience and accompanies the public debate on specific grid projects. And in my home country, Germany, early engagement of the public already starts during the drafting of the grid development plan. Nevertheless, a lot more will have to be done in terms of awareness raising, communication, and best practice sharing. Costs and benefits of a project have to be explained. New ways of dialogue and enhanced cooperation among all stakeholders is inevitable for success. I therefore welcome the Renewables Grid Initiative publication on lessons learned across Europe. We can all learn from each other and avoid previous mistakes. Therefore, I would like to express my appreciation to your work for making an excellent contribution, not just to energy infrastructure, but actually by building bridges between TSOs and civil society and showing us that dialogue can bring us further in the complex challenge of integrating European electricity. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to invite you to continue our dialogue and give the floor now to my colleague, Commissioner Potocnik. Thank you all.
Thank you.